Hello everyone, welcome to Dynamic Studies. So in the crash course of management, today is day 5 and we will discuss unit 5. The syllabus of unit 5 is value and returns, time preference of money, valuation of bonds and share, risk and return, capital budgeting, nature of investment, evaluation, comparison of capital, different structure, then methods, risk and uncertainty, dividend theories and determination, merger and acquisition, corporate restructuring, value creation, merger, negotiation, leverage, buyout, takeover, portfolio management, CAPM, APT. Then derivatives, options payout, payoffs, option pricing, forward contract, future contract, working capital management, its determinant, cash inventories, receivables and payable management, factoring, international financial management, then foreign exchange market. Let's get started. Yeah, first of all, I would like to tell you this unit is very important. Okay, in exams, various questions has been asked from this unit. Okay, so please be focused and be present while understanding this one. Okay, now first topic is time value of money. So, time value of money is a greater benefit of receiving money now rather than an identical sum later. Okay? What is time value? Actually, time value is the value of money, okay, at different time period. This is time value of money. Okay? So, this also underlines investment. Investors are willing to forego spending their money now only if they expect a favorable return on their investment in the future, such that the increased value to be available later is sufficiently high to offset the preference to have money now. Okay? Let us understand time value of money by example. We know that rupee 100 in hand today is more valuable than rupee 100 receivable after a year. We will not part any rupee 100 now if the same sum is repaid after a year. Okay, but we might part with rupee 100 now if we are assumed that rupee 110 will be paid at the end of first year. This additional compensation required for parting rupee 100 today is called interest or the time value of money. Okay, so let us discuss this rule 72. What is rule 72? Rule 72 is simplified way to determine how long an investment will take to double given fixed annual rate of interest. By dividing 72 by the annual rate of return, investor can get a rough estimate of how many years it will take for initial investment to duplicate itself. For instance, if a rate is 5%, then the doubling period is 72 by 5. Okay? So basically, this rule 72 is used to measure the doubling period. Okay, when we divide 72 by rate of interest, then we will get the doubling period. Okay, for example, that when rate is 5%, then doubling period is 72 by 5, that is 14.5 years. Okay, now there is another rule, that is rule 69. These rules are very important. Rule 69 is used to estimate the amount of time it will take for an investment to double, assuming continuously compounded interest. The calculation is to divide 69 by the rate of return for an investment and then add 0.35 to the result. For instance, if the rate is 5%, then the double period is 0.35 plus 69 divided by interest rate. Okay, so what is the difference between rule 72 and rule 69? Both measure the doubling period. Okay, but in rule 72, we just divide 72 by interest rate. But in rule 69, we divide 69 by interest rate and then add 0.35. Okay, so the doubling period for rate of interest of 5% is 0.35 plus 69 upon 5. Okay, so it would be 14.15. okay, now there is another rule, that is rule 114. This rule is used to estimate how long it takes to triple your money. Okay, so listen, in rule 72 and 69, we are measuring the doubling period. But in rule 114, we are measuring tripling period. Okay? This estimate how long it takes to triple your money divided 114 by your expected interest rate or rate of return. Okay? Rule 1. Okay. Then there is another rule. I forgot to mention it. There is another rule. Rule 144. Okay. This rule is used to estimate how long will it take to quadruple your money. Okay. You can use the number 144 dividing 114 by your expected rate of return will give the answer. Okay. So the time value of money problem involves the net value of cash flows and at different point in time. Okay. Some important calculation based on time value of money are present value of annuity, future value of annuity. Okay. So, present value, the current worth of future sum of money or stream of cash flows given a specified rate of return. Future cash flows are discounted at discount rate. Higher the discount rate, the lower the present value of future cash flows. Determining the appropriate discount rate is a key to valuing future cash flow properly, whether they be earning or obligations. And then present value of an annuity. An annuity is a series of equal payments or receipt. Okay. What is annuity? Annuity is a series of equal payments or receipt that occur at evenly spaced intervals. Okay. Like leases, rental payments are some example of this. Okay, the payment or receipt occurring at the end of each period for an ordinary annuity, while they occur at the beginning of each period for an annuity due. Okay, now present value of perpetuity. Okay, this is also another thing. This is infinity and constant stream of identical cash flow. Now future value. The value of an asset or cash at a specified date in future based on value of that asset is present. Okay. Now future value of annuity, FVA. The future value of a stream of payment, annuity, assuming the payment are invested at a given rate of interest. There are several basic equations that represent equality listed above. The solution may be found using the formulas, a financial calculator or a spreadsheet. The formulas are programmed into most financial calculator and several spread functions. And they use PV, FB, rate, NPR, PMT. Okay? Now, what is bond valuation? Bond valuation is, bond are long-term debt security issued by the companies or government entities, to raise debt finance. Okay, the formula for finding out value of bond is I interest multiplied by PVIFA plus F plus PVIF. Okay, this is the formula of bond valuation. Okay, so the bond valuation are long term debt security issued by companies, government entity to raise debt finance. Bond valuation is a method to determine the fair value of bond. The fundamental principle of bond valuation is that its value is equal to sum of present value of its expected cash flow. Okay? Now, basic rule with regard to bond valuation is cost. When required rate of return is equal to coupon rate. This question has been asked. Okay? Please be careful about this. When required rate of return, please note down all these points. When required rate of return is equal to coupon rate, bond will sell at par value. Okay. When required rate of return is greater than coupon rate, then bond sells at discount rate. When required rate of return is less than coupon rate, then bond sells at premium. Okay. And another point you have to note down is longer the maturity of bond, greater the bond price change with a given change in required rate of return. Okay. Now there is another concept, that is yield to maturity. The yield to maturity formula is used to calculate the yield on bond based on its current price on the market. The yield to maturity formula looks at the effective yield of bond based on compounding as opposed to simple yield which is found using the dividend yield formula. Okay, yield to maturity is equals to C plus future value face value minus price divided by face value plus price divided by 2. Okay, so this is the formula, that is coupon rate or interest payment plus face price face value minus price divided by n, that is year to maturity, and then whole divided by f plus p by 2. Okay, now valuation of shares. So share valuation is finding out the value of shares. Okay, there is two method of finding out the valuation of share, that is absolute valuation and relative valuation. In absolute valuation, it's a type used to calculate the intrinsic value of the share which has been discounted above. This method only focuses on fundamental of the company like dividend, cash flow and the growth rate of concerned businesses. Then relative valuation. The method under relative valuation uses ratio analysis, among others, to ascertain the value of the stock in comparison to its peer. The method under this type are numerous and are easy to use as well. Yeah, there is two popular methods, the asset approach and the income approach. The asset approach uses the company's all assets for calculation of share value, and the income approach, this use is the income. Now, risk and return. So, first of all, we will discuss risk. What is risk? This is, in this picture, there are various elements of risk is given. Risk is basically categorized into two parts, that is systematic risk and unsystematic risk. In systematic risk, they have classified the risk into three subparts, interest rate risk, market risk, purchasing power risk, okay? And in uncertainty risk, they have classified risk into two categories, that is business risk and financial risk, okay? So this is the whole diagram of risk. So what is risk? Risk is uncertainty associated with the returns from the investment that introduce risk for the investors. An investment whose return are fairly stable is considered to be the low risk investment, whereas an investment whose return fluctuates significantly is considered to be highly risky investment. Okay, now let us discuss systematic risk and unsystematic risk and all the types of systematic and unsystematic risk one by one. Okay, what is systematic risk? Systematic risk is due to the dynamic nature of society. The changes occur in economic, political and social system. Okay, is known as systematic risk. These changes have an influence on performance of companies and thereby on their stock prices, but in varying degree. For example, economic and political instability adversely affect all industry and company. Now what is unsystematic risk? Unsystematic risk are sometimes the return from a security of any company may vary because of certain factor, particularly to this company. Variability in return of security on account of these factor is known as unsystematic risk. Okay? Now the formula for measuring the systematic. So the unsystematic, we can't measure the unsystematic risk. Okay? Because this is due to society and other factors. Okay, but we can measure the systematic risk. Okay, so the formula for measuring the systematic risk, the systematic risk was written in terms of beta. Okay, and we can measure the beta when we divide covariance by variance. Okay, where covariance of RI and RM is covariance between the return on asset I and return on the market portfolio. And the sigma square RM is variance of the market. Okay, measurement of systematic risk is variability in security return caused by change in economy or market, and all security are affected by such change to some extent. Some security exhibit greater variability in response to market changes and some may exhibit less response. Security that are more sensitive to change in factors are said to have higher systematic risk. Okay, so there are various points. the security can have beta that are positive, negative or zero. Okay, so what is the mean of positive beta, negative beta and zero beta? The positive beta indicates that security's return is dependent on market return and moves in the direction in which market moves. Negative beta indicates that security return is dependent on market return but moves in the opposite direction in which market moves. Zero beta indicates security return is independent of market return. Okay, so this is all about measurement of risk, systematic risk. Okay, now measurement of risk of portfolio. Risk on portfolio can be measured by the following formula. Okay, standard deviation of portfolio consisting security A and B. Okay, WA and WB is proportion of funds invested in security A and security B. Sigma A and sigma B is standard deviation of returns of security A and B. And then correlation coefficient between return of security A and security B. The correlation coefficient can be calculated as covariance upon sigma A by sigma B. Okay. Now sharp edge ratio and trailer ratio. This is very important. Okay. Sharp edge ratio measures the risk premium per unit of total risk of the for the security or the portfolio security. Okay, the formula is sharp edge ratio is expected return of portfolio minus risk free rate divided by standard deviation of portfolio returns. Okay, then trailer's ratio. These ratios are very important. This ratio is same as sharp ratio with only difference that is measure the risk premium per unit of systematic risk, that is beta, for the security or the portfolio of security. The formula is RI, that is portfolio's return minus risk-free rate divided by portfolio beta. Okay, so the difference of in both of them is in sharp edge ratio they have divided by standard deviation, and in trainer's ratio they have divided by beta. Okay, now measurement of risk. So annual risk is measured by dividend per share plus share prices end of the year and share prices start of the year. Okay, and expected return can be measured as P1 into R1 plus P2 into R2 plus PN into RN. Okay, so these are measurement of returns. Now we will discuss what is capital budgeting. Okay, so capital budgeting is the planning process used to determine whether an organization's long-term investments such as new machinery, replacement of machinery, new plants, new product, research development project are worth the funding of cash through the firm's capitalization structure. It is the process of allocating the resource for capital or investment expenditure. Okay, one of the primary goal of capital budgeting investment is to increase the value of firm to the shareholders. Okay, there are many formal method used to capital budgeting, includes accounting rate of return, average accounting return, payback period, net present value, profitability index, internal rate of return, modified internal rate of return, equivalent annual cost or real option value. Okay, so these methods are incremental cash flow from each potential investment. Okay, and used to calculate the capital budgeting. Okay, so what is capital budgeting? Is an art of finding the assets that are worth more than they cost to achieve a predetermined goal, that is optimizing the wealth of the business enterprise. Okay, basically the organization's main objective is wealth maximization, so it helps to enhance or obtain this objective. Okay, so the capital budgeting process involves following steps, that is investment screening and selection, capital budget proposal, budgeting approval and authorization, project tracking, post completion audit. Okay, so this is capital budgeting. Now let us discuss payback period method. Payback period method, the basic element of this method is to calculate recovery time. Okay, payback period for the project, shorter the payback period, the more desirable a project is. Okay, payback period is actually the period at which, after which the amount is fully recovered. Okay, this is payback period. For example, initial investment on a project is 1 lakh and expected future cash inflow is 20,000, 40,000, 40,000, 25,000 for the next 4 years. Thus, the payback period would be 3 years as entire investment is being recovered in 3 years. Okay, that 1 lakh amount will be recovered after 3 years. That in first 1 year 20,000 and then second 40,000, that is 60,000, and then in third year 40,000 more, then total amount is 1 lakh. Okay, and in fourth year that is 25,000, so this will be considered as profit. Okay, so in payback period we measure or calculate the amount that will recovered. Okay, the initial investment when recovered is measured. Now accounting rate of return method measures increase in profit expected to result from investment. The formula for accounting rate of return is average annual profit after tax. Please note down this formula: average annual profit after tax divided by average or initial investment multiplied by 100. Okay, or we can also write it as average EBIT, earning before interest and tax, 1 minus T, T is time period, divided by average investment multiplied by 100. Okay, where average investment is initial investment plus salvage in value upon 2. Okay, now net present value method. This method involves computation of net present value or NPV. NPV is present value of cash inflow minus present value of cash outflow. Okay, now internal rate of return. Internal rate of return is percentage discount rate applied in capital investment decision, which bring the cost of project and its expected future cash inflow into equality, that is NPV is zero. The decision rule for the internal rate of return is to invest in project if its rate of return greater than its cost of capital. Okay, internal rate of return is rate of return where cash flow are discounted and then present value of cash inflow is calculated, present value of cash outflow. Now profitability index, it is the ratio of present value of cash inflow to present value of cash outflow. Profitability index is equal to PV of cash inflow divided by PV of cash outflow. When PPI, profitability index, is greater than 1, then project is accepted. When profitability index is less than 1, then project is rejected. Okay, and how we calculate profitability index? We calculate profitability index by present value of cash inflow divided by present value of cash outflow. Okay, profitability index signifies present value of inflow per rupee of outflow. It helps to compare projects involving different amount of initial investment. And then discounted payback period. In traditional payback period, the time value of money is not considered. Okay, they haven't considered the time value of money. Okay, under the discounted payback period, the expected future cash flow are discounted by applying the appropriate rate, that is the cost of capital, then discount cash inflow are used to calculate payback period. Now, capital rationing. What is capital rationing? Capital rationing is a situation where a constraint or a budget ceiling is placed on a total size of capital expenditure during a particular period. Under this situation, decision maker is compelled to reject some of the viable project having positive net present value because of shortage of fund. This question has been asked, what is capital rationing? So capital rationing is basically rejection of some viable project having positive net present value because of shortage of fund. Okay, so it is known as a situation involving capital rationing. Decision making in such situation depends upon whether the project are divisible or not. If divisible, then decision should be made based upon profitability index. If not, then table of feasible combination should be prepared. Okay, so this is all about capital budgeting. We have discussed various methods in capital budgeting also. Now let us discuss what is dividend. Okay, Dividend is a term referred to that part of profit of a company which is distributed by the company among its shareholder. It is the reward of shareholder for investment made by them in a share of company. The investors are interested in earning the maximum return on their investment and to maximize their wealth. There are various dividend theory, okay? So the dividend theories are Walters model, Gordon model, Modi, Gilani and Miller model. Okay, Walters model and Gordon model, they have accepted relevant concept of dividend, and Modi, Gilani and Miller has accepted irrelevant concept. Okay, so what is relevant concept and irrelevant concept of dividend? Relevant concept of dividend is, according to this school of thought, dividend are relevant and the amount of dividend affects the value of firm. Walton and Gordon and other popular philosophers have found that, or they assume that dividend decisions are relevant in influencing the value of firm. Okay? In irrelevant concept of dividend, the other school of thought propounded by Modi, Gilani and Miller in 1961. Okay, they assume the dividend policy, the firm's dividend policy is irrelevant. It does not affect the wealth of shareholder. They argue that value of firm depends on market price of share. The dividend decision of no use in determining the value of firm. Now let us discuss them one by one. Walters model, one of the earlier theoretical model. Walters model, one of the earlier theoretical model, clearly indicates that the choice of appropriate dividend policy always affects the value of enterprise. The formula used by Walter to determine the market price per share is P is market price per share is equal to dividend per share plus internal rate of return divided by cost of capital, and in bracket earning per share minus dividend per share and whole divided by cost of capital. So this is the formula for calculating the market price. Okay, what are the implications of this model? When growth firm, that is R, the small r value, when a smaller value is greater than cost of capital, such firm must reinvest retained earning since existing alternative investment offer a lower return. Okay, when normal firm, they have said that the firm which have greater R than cost of capital are growth firms. Okay, and the firms which have R equal to K are normal firms, and the firms which have R less than K are declining firms. Okay, so the growth firms, as I already mentioned, growth firms must reinvest retained earnings since existing alternative investment offer a lower return. Okay, now normal firms dividend policy will have no effect on the market value per share in the Walters model. Okay, now declining firms, the management of such firms should like to distribute its earning to stockholders so that they may either spend it or invest elsewhere to earn higher return than earned by decline firms. Okay, now Gordon's model. So Gordon's model, they has also developed a model on the lines of Professor Walter, suggesting that dividends are relevant and the dividend decision of firm affects its value. Okay, Gordon basic valuation formula can be simplified as under P is price of share is equal to earning per share multiplied by 1 minus retention ratio. Okay, and then whole divided by KE, that is cost of equity capital, minus BR, that is growth rate. BR can also be represented as G. Okay, so this is the formula for Gordon model. This is very important for exam point of view, and the implication of both the model is very important. Okay, so in Walter's model, if value of R is greater than K, then the firm are growth firm. When R is equal to K, then firm is then that is normal firm. when the value of R is less than K, then the firm is decline one. Okay, now let us discuss the implications of Gordon's model. Okay, so when value of R is greater than K, the price per share increases as dividend payout ratio decreases. Okay, when R is equal to K, the price per share remain unchanged. Okay, they will not affect the price of share. Okay, and is not affected by dividend policy. When value of R is less than K, the price per share increases as dividend payout ratio increases. Okay, so this is all about Walter's model and Gordon model. Please note down the formulas and learn the implications also. Now we will discuss Modi Gilani and Miller model. This model is totally opposite of the both model we have discussed earlier. Okay, so Modi Gilani and Miller model, this thought of irrelevant of dividend are most comprehensive and logical. Okay, according to them, dividend policy does not affect the value of firm. Okay, this is totally opposite of Walters and Gordon model. Okay, there is no consequences. Miller and Modi Gilani have given the proof of their argument that dividend have no effect on the firm share price in the form of set equilibrium. Okay, set equations. Now, residual dividend model. If a firm wish to avoid issue of share, then it will have to rely on internally generated fund to finance new positive NPV projects. Dividend can only be paid out of what is left over. This left over is called residual, and such dividend policy is called residual dividend policy. Okay, so this is all about residual dividend model. Now, dividend discount model. The dividend discount model is more conservative variation of discount cash flow, and that says a share of a stock is worth the present value of its future dividend rather than its earning. Okay, what is cash dividend and stock dividend? Cash dividend is by far the most important form of dividend. Okay, in cash dividend, stockholders receive checks for the amount due to them. Okay, and the stock dividends are next to cash dividend. Okay, now let us discuss mergers and acquisition. What is merger and acquisition? Merger and acquisition for short involves the process of combination of two companies into one. The goal of combination of two or more businesses is to try and achieve synergy, where the whole new company is greater than the sum of its part. Synergy is when the value of whole part is greater than the existing part. Okay, the merger is A plus B forms a C. Okay, when two companies forms a different company. Okay, and acquisition is when A plus B forms A. Okay, now the merger occurs when two companies join force. Such transaction typically happen between two businesses that are about the same size and which recognize advantage than other offers in terms of increasing sales efficiency and capabilities. The terms of merger are often fairly friendly and mutually agreed, and two companies become equal partner in a new venture. Okay, now acquisition, this is forceful one. This occur when one company buy another company and holds it into its operations. Sometimes the purchase is friendly and sometimes it is hostile, depending on whether the company being acquired believe it is better off as an operating unit of larger venture. Okay, that is A plus B forms A. Now there is an important thing, that is AS 14, Accounting Standard 14. Please note down this. AS 14 is Institute of Chartered Accountant. India has introduced Accounting Standard 14 on accounting of amalgamation. Okay, the standard recognizes two type of amalgamation: amalgamation in nature of merger and amalgamation in nature of purchase. Okay, so what is amalgamation in nature of merger? It is an amalgamation when there is a genuine pooling, not merely of assets and liability of transferor and transferee company, but also the shareholders' interest and the businesses of company. Amalgamation in nature of merger as per AS 14 satisfy all the following conditions. Okay, So, all the assets and liability of transferor company become, after amalgamation, the assets and liability of transferee company. Okay, so this is all about the nature of merger in amalgamation. Now, what is amalgamation in nature of purchase? If any one or more of above conditions are not satisfied, in amalgamation, such amalgamation is called amalgamation in nature of purchase. Okay. Now, there is another term that is purchase consideration. Purchase consideration is price payable by transferee company to transferor company for taking over the business of transferor company. Okay. Now, pooling of interest method. What is this? This is accounting method used in case of amalgamation in nature of merger. Okay, please note down this point. This is used in nature of merger. Under this method, the assets and liability and reserves of transferor company will be taken over by transferee company at existing carrying amount unless any adjustment is required due to different accounting policies. Okay, now there is another method that is purchase method. This accounting method is used when amalgamation is in nature of purchase. Okay, under this method, assets and liability of transferor company should be incorporated at their existing carrying amounts, or the purchase consideration should be allocated to individual identical assets and liability. Okay, now amalgamation adjustment reserve accounts. Normally, in amalgamation, in the nature of purchase, the identity of reserves is not preserved and the exceptions is made in respect of a statutory reserve. Now, so this is all about merger. Okay, now we will discuss internal reconstruction. What is internal reconstruction? Internal reconstruction is a process in which financial structure of a company is reorganized without dissolving the existing company and forming a new company. Internal reorganization, reconstruction include alternating of share capital, reduction of share capital, variation of shareholders' right. Okay? Now, this is very important, that is corporate restructuring. Corporate restructuring is corporate action taken to signify, modify the structure and operation of a company. This usually happens when a company is facing significant problem and in a financial jeopardy. Okay? So, it essentially the process of redesigning one or more aspect of company. So, first one is acquisition and takeover. It implies acquisition of controlling interest in company by another company. It does not lead to dissolution of company whose share are acquired. Now, demerger. It is form of corporate restructuring in which a company transfers one or more of its undertaking to another company. Now, disvestiture. What is disvestiture? It is a form of corporate restructuring which involves sale of segment of company. For cash or security, it involves sale of only some asset of firm. These assets may be plant, division, product line, subsidiary or so on. Now, buyouts. The management buyouts involves sale of existing firm to management. The management may be from the same firm or from outside, or may assure a hybrid firm. When debt forms a substantial part of total financing from outside, the buyout transaction is called levered buyout. When leveraged buyout implies acquisition of firm that is financed principally by borrowing of a security shares. Okay. Now, capital asset pricing model. First of all, we will discuss what is portfolio investment. Okay. Portfolio investment and investment in the form of groups of assets including transaction in cap equity security such as common stock, debt security, such bank note, bond, debentures. Okay. Now CAPM. CAPM is capital asset pricing model. This is used to calculate the expected rate on security. Okay. So CAPM formula is RF plus beta into RM minus RF. This is how we measure capital asset pricing. This is how we measure rate of return. Okay. कैपिटल सेट प्राइसिंग मॉडल वॉज इंट्रोड्यूस बाय जैक ट्रेलर एंड शार्पेज एंड लिंटर. ओके, दिस मॉडल डिस्क्राइब रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन एक्सपेक्टेड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न and risk of investment in security. Okay, it basically shows what the expected return on security is equal to risk free return plus risk premium. Okay, what the point you need to note is what beta denotes. Beta denotes or measure the stock risk. Okay, the fluctuation of price changes related to overall market. In other words, it is stock sensitivity to market risk. Okay, beta is measured volatility of systematic risk. Okay, so this is all about capital asset pricing model. This basically measures what expected return on security. Now let us discuss arbitrage pricing theory. Arbitrage pricing theory is the theory of assets pricing that holds that an asset's return can be forecast using the linear relationship between assets and expected return. So the formula for calculating the asset pricing model is ERJ is equal to RF plus beta 1 RP1 plus beta 2 RP2 plus beta n RPn. Okay, so this is all about arbitrage theory. Now let us discuss what is derivative. So derivative are of four types: forward, future, options and swap. Okay, options are of two type: call option and put options. Okay, and swaps are of internal rate swap and currency swaps. Okay, derivative is a contract. What is derivative? It is a contract between two or more parties whose value is based on agreed upon underlying financial asset. What you need to note is underlying assets. What are underlying financial assets? They are like security, set of assets including indexes, common underlying instrument like bonds, commodity, currencies, interest rate, market indexes and stocks. All these assets which can be considered as underlying to be derivative product are subject to change in value. Okay, so as I already mentioned types of derivative. Okay, now we will discuss participant in derivative market. So the participant in derivative market are four categories, divided into four categories. First one is hedgers, speculator, margin trader and arbitrageurs. Now hedgers are trader who wish to protect themselves from the risk involved in price movement. Okay, speculator, unlike hedgers, look for opportunity to take on risk in hope of making returns. Then arbitrage trader is a low risk trade where a simultaneous purchase of security is done in one market and corresponding sale in carried out in another market. Now margin trader and speculator who make use of payment mechanism which is peculiar to the derivative market. Okay, now let us discuss what is future and forward contract. Future are a standardized contract and they are traded on the exchange. On the other hand, forward contract is agreement between two parties and is traded over the counter. Okay, so this is the basic difference between forward and future contract. First one is meaning. The meaning of future contract is standardized contract traded on exchange to buy and sell underlying instrument at certain date in future specified price. And this is standardized contract. They have less counterparty risk. They have contract size standardized or fixed. They are regulated by stock exchange. Collateral is initially margin required. Okay, settlement is on daily basis. Okay, or in contrary to forward contract, they have settlement on daily, maturity date. Collateral is not required. Regulation is self-regulatory. Contract size is customized. Counterparty risk is high. In the structure is customized contract. The forward contract is agreement between two parties to buy or sell underlying assets at a specified date at agreed rate in future. Now option contract. What is option contract? Option is the most important part of derivative contract, and option contract gives the right but not an obligation to buy or sell underlying assets. Okay, so this is all about future forward contract and option market. Now, yeah, there is another thing that is Bloch's model. This has been asked in exam before. Bloch's model is another commonly used option pricing model. This model was discovered in 1973 by economist Fisher Black. This question has been asked that who have developed this model. So the answer is Fisher Black and Myron Scholes. Both have received the Nobel Prize. Okay, the main advantage of this model is it lets you calculate a very high number of option price in very short time. Okay, so there is another term that is swap. Swap is derivative contract made between two parties to exchange cash flows. Okay, receiver will receiver and payer floating exchange rate, that LIBOR, and payer's fixed rate. Now, what is working capital? Working capital refers to the circulation of capital required to meet day-to-day operation of business firm. Working capital is defined as excess of current assets over current liability. As I mentioned in the formula, that is CA minus CL is equal to WC. Okay? So, the term working capital is often refers to circulating capital also. Okay? So this can be asked, there's what is circulating capital? Working capital is circulating capital. Okay? So net working capital is calculated as in the formula given. Now let us discuss what is gross working capital. Gross working capital refers to the investment in total current circulating asset. It is excess of current assets over current liability. Now, permanent working capital, it refers to the minimum amount of investment in all current assets which is required at all time to carry out minimum level of business activities. Tandon Committee has referred to this working capital as core current assets. This is important. Tandon Committee has referred that working capital are core current assets. Okay? Now, temporary working capitals. These are the amounts such working capital keeps on fluctuating from time to time on the basis of business activities. For example, extra inventory has to be maintained to support sales during peak sale period. Now, what is working capital cycle? Working capital cycle for a business is length of time in taking to convert net working capital into cash. Okay? So, this is all about working capital. Now we will discuss factoring. Okay? So what is factoring? Factoring is very important as exam point of view. Most of the question on the factoring has been asked in exam. Okay? So, yeah, factoring. Factoring is financial transaction where an entity sales its receivable to third party called factor at discounted price. Factoring is financial option for the management of receivable. In simple definition, it is conversion of credit sale into cash. In factoring, a financial institute buys the accounts receivable of a company and pay up 80% to 90% of amount immediately on formation of agreement. Okay? So this is the method of factoring. Okay, so this is all about factoring. Now we will discuss international financial management. Okay, so what are international finance? International finance is also refers an international monetary economy or international macroeconomics. It is a branch of economics broadly concerned with monetary and macroeconomic interrelationship. Okay. So, the major three component of international finance is foreign exchange and political risk, market imperfection, expanded opportunity sets. Okay, now international financial management is also known as international finance is the management of finance in an international business environment, that is trading and making money through exchange of foreign currencies. The international financial activities help organization to connect with international dealing with overseas business partners, customers, suppliers, lenders, and so on. It is also used by government organization. Okay. So, four major phases which differentiate international financial management from domestic are इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ फॉरेन करेंसी, पॉलिटिकल रिस्क, मार्केट इंपरफेक्शन एंड एनहेंस अपॉर्चुनिटी सेट्स. ओके, इंटरनेशनल फाइनेंशियल मैनेजमेंट इज कैटेगराइज इनटू थ्री कैटेगरीज, इंटरनेशनल कैपिटल बजटिंग, इंटरनेशनल सोर्स ऑफ फाइनेंस, इंटरनेशनल वर्किंग कैपिटल मैनेजमेंट. इंटरनेशनल कैपिटल बजटिंग और मल्टीनेशनल कैपिटल बजटिंग हैज़ टू बी टेकन इनटू कंसिडरेशन द डिफरेंट फैक्टर वेरिएबल विच अफेक्ट अ फॉरेन प्रोजेक्ट एंड आर कॉम्प्लेक्स इन नेचर देन डोमेस्टिक प्रोजेक्ट. द फैक्टर क्रूशियल इन सच सिचुएशन आर कैश फ्लोज फ्रॉम फॉरेन प्रोजेक्ट और पेरेंट कैश फ्लोज आर क्वाइट डिफरेंट फ्रॉम प्रोजेक्ट कैश फ्लोज. नाउ प्रॉफिट रिमिट टू पेरेंट्स फर्म. फोर्थ वन इज इफेक्ट ऑफ फॉरेन एक्सचेंज. चेंज इन रेट ऑफ इन्फ्लेशन रिस्ट्रिक्टेड इम्पोज ऑन कैश इन फ्लो. सो दीज आर द फैक्टर्स विच अफेक्टेड. नाउ वॉट इज एडजस्टेड प्रेजेंट वैल्यू. एडजस्टेड प्रेजेंट वैल्यू इज यूज टू वैल्यूएट फॉरेन प्रोजेक्ट्स. APV model is the value additive approach to capital budgeting process, that is each cash flow is considered individually and discounted at a rate consistent with risk involved in cash flow. Different component of project cash flow have to be discounted separately. Now what is international source of fund? So the formula for adjusted present value is this shown in figure. Okay. Now international source of finance. International source of finance. Indian companies have been able to tap global market to raise foreign currency fund by issuing various type of financial instrument. Okay. Now what are foreign currency convertible bonds? Foreign currency convertible bonds are foreign currency, usually dollar denominated debt raised by companies in international markets, but which have the option of converting into equity share of a company before they mature. And then there is a term that is depository receipts. Depository receipts are financial instruments that represent share of local company but are listed and traded on a stock exchange outside the country. Now there is a concept of ADR and GDR. Depository receipts are also called American depository receipt if they are listed on a stock exchange in USA. Okay. If a depository receipt is listed in a stock exchange outside the USA, they are called global depository receipt. Okay. Then there is a concept of IDR. IDR is a foreign currency can assist Indian security market for raising fund through issue of Indian depository receipt. When depository receipts are issued in India and listed in a stock exchange here with foreign stock or underlying shares, these are called Indian depository receipts. Now let us discuss what is international working capital. The management of working capital is an international firm is much more complex as compared to domestic one. The study of international working capital management requires knowledge of multinational cash management, international inventory management and international receivable management. The main objective of this is to minimize currency exposure risk, to minimize overall cash requirement of a company, to minimize transaction cost, minimize currency political risk. Okay. Now there is a term that is leading and lagging technique. This technique is used to subsidiary for optimize cash flow movement by adjusting the timing of payment to determine expectations about future currency movement. Okay. Now there is a term that is netting. What is netting? Netting is a technique of optimizing cash flow movement with combined efforts of subsidiary, thereby reducing administrative and transaction costs resulting from currency conversion. There are two type of nettings. Bilateral netting system. It involves transaction between the parent and subsidiary or between two subsidiaries. Then multinational netting system. Each affiliated nets all its inter-affiliated receipt amongst all its disbursement. If transfer or receive the balance on the position of it being a net receiver or a payer, thereby resulting in saving in transfer exchange cost. So, this is all about netting and international working capital. Now let us discuss the forex market. Okay, first of all we will discuss the participant in forex market. Participant in forex market are corporate, commercial banks, exchange brokers, central banks. Okay, these are the participants in foreign exchange market. So there is a term that is SWIFT. The full form of SWIFT is Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunications. This is a cooperative society owned by about 250 banks in Europe and North America, registered as cooperative society in Brussels, Belgium. It is communication network for international financial market transaction linking effectively more than 25,000 financial institutes throughout the world who have been allotted bank identified code. The message are transmitted from country to country by central interconnected operation center. Then there is another term, that is CHIPS. CHIPS stands for Clearing House Interbank Payment System. It is electronic payment system owned by 12 private commercial banks constituting the New York Clearing House Association. A CHIP began its operation in 1971. Has grown to be the world's largest payment system. Foreign exchange and euro dollar transactions are settled through CHIPS. Now, what is two-way quotation? Typically, the quotation is an interbank market in a two-way quotation. It means rate quoted by the market maker will indicate two prices. Okay? There is another term, that is direct quotation. The exchange quotation which gives the price for foreign currency in terms of domestic currency is known as direct quotation. Okay? Then there is indirect quotation, that is there is another way of quotation in which foreign exchange market the Mumbai bank quote rate for dollar is rupee 100, USD 2.07620767. This type of quotation which gives the quantity of foreign currency per unit of domestic currency. So this is all about foreign exchange. Now we will discuss Foreign Exchange Market Act 1999 or FEMA. It has been introduced as replacement of earlier Foreign Exchange Regulation FERA Act. FEMA came into act on its first day of June 2000. The main objective behind the Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999 is to consolidate amend law relating to foreign exchange with objective of facilitating external trade and payment for promotion, the orderly development and maintenance of foreign exchange market. So what is now there is another term that is LIBOR. LIBOR is London Interbank Offer Rate. It is a global reference rate for unsecured short-term borrowing in interbank market. Now there is another term that is derivative in forex market. They play a crucial role in developing the foreign exchange market as they enable market player to hedge against underlying exposure and shape the overall risk profile of participant in market. Now there are various terms that are Nostro, Vostro and Loro accounts. In interbank transaction, foreign exchange is transferred from one account to another account. From one center to another center, they are of the bank maintain three type of current accounts in order to facilitate quick transfer of fund in different currencies. These are Nostro, Vostro and Loro accounts, means our, your and their. A bank foreign currency account maintained by the bank in foreign currency and in home currency is known as Nostro account, or our account is you. For example, an Indian bank's Swiss franc France account in Bank of Switzerland. Okay, now your account is us. For example, Indian account maintained by Bank of Switzerland. Now what is purchasing power parity? Purchasing power parity theory focuses on the inflation exchange rate relationship. There are two forms of purchasing power parity theory. Absolute form, that is law of one price, suggests the price of similar product of two different countries should be equal when measured in common currency. And then relative form of purchasing power parity try to overcome the problem of market imperfection and consumption pattern between different countries. Now what is international Fisher effect? This theory uses interest rate rather than inflation rate differential to explain why exchange rate change over time. But it is closely related to purchasing power parity theory because interest rates are often high correlated with inflation rate. Okay? Now what is foreign exchange exposure? Foreign exchange exposure refers to those part of country's business that would be affected if exchange rate changes. Okay? Now, what is transaction risk? Transaction risk is the exchange rate change between transaction date and subsequent settlement date. It is gain or loss arise on a conversion. This type of risk is primarily associated with import and export. Now, economic risk. A firm has economic risk, also known as forecast risk, to the degree that its market value is influenced by unexpected exchange rate fluctuation. Okay? Now, what is translation risk? The financial statement of overseas subsidiary is usually translated into home currency in order that they can be consolidated into groups. Financial statement. Note that this is purely a paper-based exercise. This is translate, not the conversion of real money from one currency to another. Translation risk deal with risk to the company equity. So, this is all about Unit 5. I had discussed all the concepts in Unit 5 thoroughly. I hope you have understood all the topics, that is working capital, derivative, arbitrage theory, CAPM, merger, demerger. Okay, so I have discussed all the topics thoroughly. If you feel like any problem or don't understand any terms, so you can ask me in comment section. Thank you. Keep learning. Keep watching. Have a nice day.